Hey everyone, I'm Hyperion, and I decided to record the solution to my New Year's puzzle, which I hosted on the January 1st, 2015. And I decided to do post-commentary so I could record the run and talk a little bit about what I did in the run, a few other routing possibilities, and to make the whole thing a little bit more interesting in general. This run was done on the PAL version of Ocarina of Time, which is slower because of the frame rate, but I thought I could record it with a little bit better execution that way, and it also gives me a little bit more time to explain a few things. First things first, I want to apologize to everyone who participated in the puzzle race. This was my first puzzle, and I had a little bit of trouble wording all of the restrictions precisely. I updated the restrictions a little bit during the race and afterwards, so the finished goals like pastebin and image can be found in the links below the video. I also wrote them down in the left of the screen so everyone can read them, but I'll go a little bit into the restriction changes and wording changes during the escape cutscene. Yeah, so during the recording of this I figured out a few more optimizations. The original solution actually used to beat Dodongo's or Fire Temple to access Dodongo's cavern later on. But you can skip that completely if you do a few things later on in the run, which I'll show as well. The cutscenes take a little bit longer on the PAL version, so if you want to just watch gameplay and the main important category things, I'll probably switch to most important things during the run, so you can skip the cutscenes if you want to. I'm just going to talk a little bit about background knowledge and maybe other planning things of the puzzle during the cutscenes. For example, Master Sword cutscene or Light Arrow cutscene will take quite a bit of time. But yeah, there were quite a few restrictions I had to enforce in order to avoid breaking the puzzle completely. I thought it would hint a little bit on what to do, but a lot of people ended up quite confused with the few abilities they had. Yeah, so at the beginning of the puzzle you could barely do anything without the ability to buy stuff. So most people got just Kokiri Sword, maybe Deku Nuts in Sacred Forest Meadow, and then did Aqua Escape. Hello. There are quite a few warp songs you need to play to optimize this, so it's beneficial to get the Ocarina early. And you need to enter Kakariko Village anyway, so I thought a few people would do Wes's Cave, but it's of course not too good if you're not consistent at it. And you usually don't want to waste time executing difficult tricks if they aren't necessary in a puzzle. Like, I thought people did different approaches to some of the parts. Like, there's a minimalistic approach where you just do the barely minimum which is necessary to finish a goal. And there's also the approach where you try to collect as much as possible on the way to have an easier time fighting enemies with more hearts or having extra items so you don't end up like out of explosives. And I picked the file name IC because that was the generated letter combination by RaceBot during the race. But yeah, I wasn't participating in the race, of course. Yeah, so It seems like rupees are basically completely forbidden in this category, but the restriction has one little there's one part where the rule doesn't apply to, or isn't supposed to apply to, which is Ganon's castle. But you can't access it early. But I'm actually spending 200 rupees there, so I want to collect a few rupees on the way. I decided to do bottom of the well with the chew chest, so I'm not worrying about collecting any rupees on the way. And I'm still using my old school escape setup. I know the new one is a little bit faster, but I'm currently sticking to this one. I messed up the inputs there for a little bit, but I was able to readjust that. It's not that precise. So yeah, I'm watching the cutscene now, and this gives me a little bit of time to explain about what I changed in the wording of the puzzle. At first, people asked what a stretched gossip stone was, and that's why I rewrote it to blow up an inflated or bloated gossip stone which touches solid ice. That means that it's not only stretched like it would be stretched if you slash it with a megaton hammer, for example, but I meant that it had more volume than before, and the gossip stone I was referring to isn't completely in ice, it's just like halfway covered in ice, so I rewrote that to which touches solid ice instead of which is surrounded by solid ice. And you can't freeze it by using ice arrows, for example. So there's no other way of creating solid ice around it, except by maybe luring a giant lever to the, let's say, Desert Colossus gossip stone. Which would be kind of awesome if people did that, but I guess that was a little bit too much out of the way after deleting Requiem later on. Technically, I didn't want to create an order in which the goals have to be done in, but I kind of intended it to do the shoot the arrows first and then blow it up, because I said it was like the grand finale. And it makes the equipments way easier, but I'll get to that later on, which different equips you can do. To finish the child section, you have to get bomb juice. And I know that the restrictions were kind of weird, and it's problematic to go back in time if you mess up the first child segment. And yeah, I need to apologize for that, because people had to reset like 1 hour or even more into the race, which is kind of dumb, I know that, but that's why it's kind of beneficial to create extra save files if you copy them to another slot, for example. Yeah, the time of day is actually important in this one. Of course, it's not too important in a race where you need time to figure out everything anyway. But it's really beneficial if you want to go fast. Like, this recording isn't perfectly executed, I have to admit that. But yeah, I'm like 10 minutes away from a good run, basically. As a preparation for RBA later on, you need a bottle. And It's actually funny that you can get two different bottles, because you can't do can't have anything in the child item trade slot. You are not allowed to get to wake up Talon without like weird BA stuff or something like that. So what you do is you can either get the cuckoo bottle like I did, because it's on the way to the bottom of the well anyway. The other method would be getting Ruto bottle, which you need to do later anyway, but you can't empty it, because it's a crucial part of the puzzle that you have Ruto's letter with you at the end of the run. But it's supposed to be obtained in Child 2. But you can also damage yourself, so you can get a fairy spawn from the rocks in Sora's domain and destroy the rock right next to the Sora, which you need for the diving game, and then you're allowed to spend the 20 rupees. But it relies heavily on RNG, and it's not as cool to watch or record, so yeah, the RBA route with that is pretty fancy, I guess. I decided to collect 4 cuckoos and do the last 3 later on. I'm not sure if that's faster in this part, but I did it anyway. And yeah, my execution in that part is quite horrible. Also, the emulator lags every now and then, so sorry for that, but I couldn't fix it. I sometimes tried to cut out the lag in the video editing, but it didn't work the way I planned it to, so it looks sometimes worse than before. I thought I had opened the small chest there right at the beginning, but I sometimes mess stuff up when I'm looking not on the screen. Yeah, I changed some of the restrictions because I had a few typing mistakes and I worded one part wrong. And I changed the order of the restrictions, so it's like it has a lot more sense to it to have like the general rules first and then restrictions on the inventory and so on. I'm not really good at bottom of the well, and I'm even worse if I have to do it shieldless. But you can't obtain shields as Child Link except the mirror shield. Or, yeah, that's the only feasible part in this run. So yeah, I messed up a little bit. I tried to recover there a little bit. It was really sloppy. And then I missed the rupee chest. When I like had the bad positioning there, I tried to jump slash early. And then I completely messed up the position. Unfortunately, I got a lucky jump slash. I just went for it there. And I hit him. I was trying to go for a quick vine clip this time, but I'm usually having problems buffering, that's why I tried to get a 2-pause, but I missed a frame there. Then I had to redo it. This part is quite laggy on emulator and even on N64, but it's usually not a big deal to get it. Thank you. Yeah, but emulator lag is really inconsistent on that part. Yes, so while I'm in bottom of the well, I figured I could as well collect sticks and Deku nuts, which I need for Spirit Temple. So I already collected one Deku stick right at the entrance of bottom of the well. And there's a Deku nut chest, which I've deemed kind of slow to get, so I decided to farm the Deku Baba instead. And ideally you would get a total amount of 5 Deku sticks and 5 Deku nuts after exiting this room. I messed up quite bad there. I thought it would be better to get 10 Deku nuts there, but it's easy to get more Deku nuts in Spirit Temple as well. And since I messed up one of the fights with the Deku Baba there, I lost a little bit of time, but you can see me adjust to the changing counts later on, so it's not a big deal if you only get like one or two Deku sticks here. You just need to be careful to not break them. Yeah, so this section is really slow, but it makes the rest in Spirit Temple go a lot more smooth. Yeah, that was weird, that the emulator lag there. For some reason I decided to go for a death warp at the Skulltula, though it's way too high. And yeah, my equips are really subpar in this part. I decided to equip the bottle and catchbox in Kakariko after that, so it's not too much time wasted. But I have to open the menu anyway. Maybe it's just easier to get bottle in the first place before entering bottom of the well. Since I already collected the first 4 cuckoos, I can finish the cuckoo bottle right now by collecting the remaining 3. And then I can head off where the route starts getting interesting. I was trying to incorporate a few things which aren't common in speedruns nowadays, or not, at least not in the popular categories. The original route I had for this before I finished every restriction of the puzzle was slightly different. And many of the things you see here were kind of, or not right now, but later on, were kind of was what I came up shortly before hosting the puzzle. And I decided to make the approaches a little bit more open because the restrictions already forced way too much, like routing-wise. But the problem is if I let one thing go through which wasn't forbidden or was forbidden with the current rule set, it would have broken the other parts so much that you could have basically skipped most interesting parts of the puzzle, and that was what I was trying to avoid there. That's why the rule set looks super strict on that part. That was beautiful bonk. Ow. 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 Okay, so I'm not on a really strict cycle here, but if I can manage the daytime efficiently, you'll see me later on entering Hyrule Castle without having to wait too long. So that's beneficial in that sense. I got the Wes here, which was a pretty fast one, but the problem was getting over the bridge is really difficult. I got quite lucky here. The weird movement after exiting Kakariko Village was to avoid the owl trigger. It saves time to avoid the owl in the English or slower languages. I think it's slightly faster to talk to it on Japanese or Chinese. But yeah, I decided to do Wes all across, but I dropped Wes ESS position during the angle change. And I thought it would be faster to skip the owl, but the extra movement I did there wasn't really worth it. If I had just got the other angle change, I would have been way faster and saved a lot of time there. I haven't timed it, but it might be possible to get... No, wait, never mind. I totally forgot that I got Requiem later on. And Requiem cutscene changes the time of day, so the time of day here isn't important at all. If you're really slow... I'm not sure if that's, like... It's impossible that if you're really slow you can enter Garuda Fortress at night, and but it doesn't really matter, like the vision of the guards isn't that important unless you're getting caught after Cuckoo Skip. I know that Garnitrax has a setup for this part, but you need to shield drop the Cuckoo in order to do his exact setup, so what I did there was I kind of aligned my angle before taking off with the Cuckoo, and then I basically ESS turned all the way right and then changed, I think it was 4 frames left, to have the Cuckoo wing, the left Cuckoo wing above the lady there. And I choked a little bit at pause buffering here, and I thought the 1 frame I got earlier was the correct one to jump slash. Then I thought, yeah, okay, this is the correct one. I didn't want to risk getting caught here, but by moving there, the guards changed their movements, and I didn't want to get them out of sync, but I got pretty lucky there eventually. Or, yeah, I just didn't have to wait another 10 seconds. You don't need to get the Gerudo membership card at all in this route. I'll talk about these little details probably during the Master Sword cutscene. But yeah. What you want to do now is just do the gate skip with the fast way. You can also unload the area, which can be done as adult as well. But you need to access a certain part of Garuda Fortress and do Seam Walk, which is slow, so you just do this one. I think there's like a complete setup where you get the angle, climb up the ladder, then tap down, target, side hop, back walk, side hop. But I was afraid of voiding out there, so I just went safe basically. If you want to cross Haunted Wasteland as Stealth Link, you basically do the same thing as if you don't have Hammer Boots or Longshot as Adult Link. The side hop after the sand pit is easier as Stealth, even though you're backwalking slower technically. But yeah, I'm sorry for the slow movement there. I wanted to get a good angle before I started back walking. I'm barely moving there because it's on the one hand it's a slower frame rate at all, and the rolls are shorter on the other hand. So like rolling in Haunted Wasteland seems really slow as Stealth Link on the PAL version. But yeah, I almost went out there after targeting lever. Fortunately I had some way to move to the right there. I'd say Spirit Temple is the most interesting part of the run, although it's really early. Like, a good puzzle usually makes people think before they start routing it. And there's like some kind of highlight at the end which you have to figure out to beat the puzzle. Most of my puzzle was figuring out how to do Child 1, and then it's only a slightly tricky part in the adult section. But it's actually beneficial to get Requiem as Child to not cross Haunted Wasteland as adult. The only reason why you need to enter the Spirit Temple is basically to get Mirror Shield, and you need Mirror Shield in order to RBA with the restrictions I posted. The problem with that is you don't have a shield for some of the cool tricks in Spirit Temple, and that forces you to do the temple in a little bit different, with different strats basically, and it makes it a lot more challenging. I'm not sure if like the strats were known for this. At least it was not common knowledge. Like, some of the streamers or runners in the race figured it out for themselves, others got a little bit of help, but this was like, Spirit was by far the most difficult execution wise part. I wanted to make the puzzle a little bit more beginner friendly in the first place, but this trick seemed to bug most people. Yeah, sorry again, I didn't know VC textures were so bad for this part. Yeah, so when you think the real fun starts, you have to talk to Nibiru, and it's taking ages. I didn't even know that Nibiru made a sound when she was getting up there. I tried to mash through these text boxes, and I selected the fast choices for her, which are the lowest ones always. What was kind of interesting, when I entered the temple, I rolled into the pot and I got invincibility frame during the collection, so I didn't take damage while collecting the heart. my spirit temple wasn't executed perfectly in this part. But I'm usually not that low on health when I'm going through this. Yeah, so what's coming up is I need to get a few keys. And there are speed tricks to speed this up. Like, if you've played Glitchless before, you know a few of the strats, but you usually have Din's Fire here, or Ferocious Wind, and you can't use that right now, because there's no way of obtaining magic at the beginning. What I did at the beginning was to just clean up all of the enemies in the first room. And I usually thought it would be fastest to use a Deku stick. But I figured out as I was like routing the puzzle itself that you can just throw a Deku nut. And it's really fast to stun the keys that way. But you can also jump slash with a Kokiri sword while the Armos is stunned, and that way you can kill it. I messed up like a little bit of that part, so I wasted a few seconds there. What was really weird was I got hit by the spike blade, but it also triggered like the cutscene. And it might have been the end of my roll, I'm not completely sure about that. But I somehow didn't take damage. What you can do here is pull out a chew and drop it on like the second red flash if you're standing close to the ledge. I almost fell off at that part. But yeah, the Stealthos can really troll you. You avoid fighting him completely if you throw a nut right as you enter the room. And yeah, the hitbox trolled me there really badly. And I almost fell off there because I grabbed the end of the ledge there. And the problem is you can't trigger the switch away. Like, you can usually just shoot slingshot seeds or the boomerang, but there's no way of obtaining them right now. And they aren't beneficial for the rest of the puzzle, so don't need to do that. I just collected a heart there to be a little bit safe on the last parts. Sometimes the green bubble can troll you and push you off. This category actually visits almost every crawl space in the whole game. I think it only skips the one before Zelda's Lullaby and in Deku Tree. And the room I entered just before the current one was where you get bomb drop and Deku nut drop. But I can't get bomb drops right now, so it's only useful if you need Deku nuts. And the setup I use here requires me to hold straight down after the last side hop, but I was still in like weird direction and carried the momentum. That was kind of bad. Fortunately, my chew didn't trigger the crystal switch to drop the Deku shield and chew chest, because I don't need any more chews in this route. Or I need one more or two more. It's not too big of a deal at the moment because I still have 7 remaining. I really messed up this room. Like, the fast way would be lighting a deku stick and then having perfect movement up to this room and light a torch after entering it to avoid collecting the rupees. If you're adult, you can use fire arrows, or Gin's fire is the most, like, the fastest way of doing this. So there are basically three things to do in this room. One is to pull this block to open the bars again. One is to collect all of the rupees to light the metal torch. And then you can light the other torches to spawn the small key chest. And this is kind of weird because quite a few people made it to this part of the run, but they didn't get the mirror shield because they didn't know how to get the mirror shield without hovering across the gap. So yeah, this was basically where you had to know that you can cross the gap to the adult side without having explosives or a shield. I'll show that after this room, actually. Like, if you get mirror shield, if you get the silver gauntlets, you basically mess up the complete puzzle and have to start over again, or from your last save file, basically. And it was really interesting to see people figuring this out, like, should I use the key, what can I do with silver gauntlets and so on. And yeah, that was like the real puzzle for the child section. There were a few other finicky things as well, but this was probably where people spent the most time on. And especially after figuring out what to do here, how to execute it recently. Shoutouts to Brian MP at this point, who uploaded the most watched video for this setup. There have been a few other setups as well, but his video was like the one most people watched to figure it out. No, I failed the first attempt there, and I was kind of salty. But that was a sweet quick draw. I changed the setup a little bit, but I couldn't like upload the video before doing the puzzle because everyone would have guessed that it might have been a part of the puzzle. So yeah, the first section is a little bit of alignment, but then you can just inch your way out to the end of the shoulder, basically. Then you do four backflips, which are really short because there's like weird invisible walls there. Then you turn right, and then I usually go for a slow alignment with the angle there, but I somehow felt like I needed to be fast. And this is a short setup to get down there on the arm without falling down, because that was a really tricky part when everyone thought, hey, I made it across. And then they fell down that section. That was really trolly. Again, sorry for the people who had to endure this, both viewers and people in the race. I thought it would be easier to do. But yeah, the angle I got there, where most people had trouble with the C up alignment, was ESS all the way to the right, and then ESS left for 2 frames, and then you're good to go. Now this section is where I need another Chu to kill the Beamos. I wanted to ban Chus completely in the first part, and then maybe do Spirit with Boomerang, for example. But this was the only room which required you to have Chus if you want to get Mirror Shield as child. And I tried to go for a little alignment there, but I slashed the wall instead of jump slashing it. If you wait for a Link to stand up, it's quite easy, but then I just like walked a little bit and then I was fine. As you noticed, I used 5 Deku Nuts to this point. And if you have 5 Deku Nuts and you get the other Deku Nuts after the first, after the second crawl space in Spirit Temple, you're basically set up. This fight was kind of sloppy when I wanted to not die there. And it was kind of scary that I took a damage from the throne. What I'm doing here is basically just casual strats. I've seen quite a few people do this casually, where they just jump slash, although they have shield at this point usually. I've seen Runner Guy do jump slashing him, and because Chart Link's hitbox is so small, the Iron Knuckle can barely hit you, but if you mess it up some way, you're really screwed. And I didn't want to have a horrible child segment or a horrible spirit segment, so I decided to go for safe snow strats. And since I didn't have enough Deku sticks for later on anyway, I did the last hit with another Deku stick. It doesn't really save time. But just as a heads up, you need or you want 4 Deku sticks later on. So yeah, that was the child section of Spirit Temple. We'll return to this place later on, but I'll explain a little bit about that when we're that far. There's no way to cross Gerudo Gate from the opposite side without hovering over the gate. So you have to escape the forest one more time. It's really fine if you do Aqua Escape. But since the time of day is messed up, or is like set to a specific part, like it's really close to night now, and you want to enter the castle to go adult because you've done everything, it might not be possible to do with the Echo Escape. So yeah, on my way to the guard, I accidentally targeted that girl, and I messed up my ESS angle change. But luckily I still got a decent angle there, like it's completely random if you target something on the way what your angle is. But you usually can get one or two different ESS angles to make it through. And yeah, I was still able to do it from that side. If I'm targeting the sign, when I'm approaching from the other side it's easy. But I luckily was still able to make it that way. I have aligned with like some part of ground texture to backwalk to the castle, and I need to load the bridge while it's still down, and that has to be before it's night, so it's important that I don't waste too much time moving across Hyrule Field there. And yeah, it would be really disappointing if I had to wait the whole night cycle here, so what I was doing there is like a really slow way of getting castle after night. And it's not really a setup, but I just wanted to approach with a decent angle. So yeah, by side hopping onto the chain, I loaded the bridge, and the bridge was pulled up all the way, so it took me with it, and I was able to get into the market area. Okay, so basically this is still a very long cutscene coming up, but I'm explaining a little bit more about stuff I wanted to do, or different approaches to the puzzle. But yeah, first we have to do a Dwarf Time Skip, and I'm really bad at the inputs for Sword Dwarf Time Skip since I've practiced the No Wrong Warp route, and so yeah, I'm doing Swordless here because I'm kind of more consistent at that one for some reason. Yeah, I would have probably paused, and if I hadn't got the one pause, I would have stayed there, like buffered for 15 seconds. I think it's possible to finish this puzzle in 2 hours on the NTSC English version, but I haven't timed it, so just by doing this route a little more consistently and with faster movement and the higher frame rate, you should be able to end up with roughly 2 hours. Okay, so I basically got 99 rupees. I got the ocarina, I got a bottle, and I got mirror shield. I don't need the rupees right now, so it's not too important. But yeah, as like a short recap of what the race looked like. A lot of people like started into the race and they did a lot of things. Like most puzzles start like, yeah, just do a couple of things and then you try to figure out what you're doing while you're executing some other things. This route or this puzzle has so many restrictions that it's difficult to remember all of them at the beginning. So I noticed that myself before I came up with the puzzle, that it had way too many restrictions, but I couldn't cut any of them to make it still a puzzle. And so it was kind of natural that some people couldn't like remember everything, and they spent rupees on accident without having a fairy close to them, for example. And that's why so many people had to reset into that. But yeah, it's kind of cool if you can get Ruto Bottle in Child 1. It saves a little bit of time if you get good RNG. But we'll do that in Child 2 and you'll see why it's pretty fast that way too. Yeah, so sorry again for everyone who had to reset like an hour into the run because they messed up something. Like someone used choose to beat Fire Temple. That was like it's not even necessary to beat Fire Temple depending on what you do, but if you do it with choose, it kind of kills some part of the road. So yeah, it was like it was important to not break any of the rules in order to make it like still kind of puzzle and not like a complete just restriction race. I kind of distinguish between like three stages. Like if you're playing bingos, you have a few goals and you try to complete them as fast as possible, and you usually know all of the tricks and everything. It's just like execution and routing. Then there's like restriction races, where you can't do a lot of things which you usually used to do, and so you have to come up with backup strats, or it just requires a different set of knowledge, I guess. But you can still complete it if you know a lot about the game. But then there are like puzzles, and what I was thinking when I hear a puzzle, thinking that you can't just start, but you have to like consider so many things. And you usually don't know the intended solution right at the start, or maybe another solution which wasn't intended, but there's at least one point where you have to figure out something which is more complicated than I'd consider part of a restriction run, kind of. So I wanted to add like a few little things which were more difficult to figure out. I know that it requires like a lot of background knowledge, and people who just run, say, any percent no away in Wrong Warp might not be able to finish this puzzle at all, because you need to BA later on. But yeah, it's I can say now 4 people out of 11 finished this part of this puzzle, and the times were kind of high because crossing the adult section in Spirit Temple took most people like an hour or maybe longer to figure out or to execute it. And I felt really bad for some of them because they really made it all the way across and then they fell off, or one died to the Iron Knuckle, unfortunately. Like, that was a really troll part of the run, I guess. And yeah, it's really important that you enter the adult section with Mirror Shield, otherwise you won't be able to turn child again. So it's like a one-way road at that point, and if you missed it, you basically had to restart. Yeah, so I was kind of concerned that people were able to figure out really bad ways to break the puzzle, because I've been around in the community for a little bit, but I'm far from knowing most of the important things in the game. So I thought maybe people did crazy stuff before and they could get hover boots early and then like, maybe go back in time without using RBA at all. And so I thought it would be... I tried to figure out every possible way to get hover boots, and it turned out that you can get hover boots only late into the run without like figuring out a completely new theory of obtaining hover boots. And yeah, so the easiest section would probably be get magic, P8 Inspire and play Nocturne. But that is obviously slow and it isn't really helpful at that point. Yes, and magic, getting magic is really complicated as well. At least for the beginning of it. So yeah, the adult section isn't too big of a deal. You just need to figure out a few things and you can beat Forest without any problem. I had quite a few bad equips here. What I didn't really like about this puzzle is that it's like, if you figure out what to do as adult, it's just a bunch of execution things, and I allowed a few other options, which might not be the fastest, but skip a few of the like thinking heavy parts. But it makes something at the end really annoying, and I'll get to that later on when I'll explain that part. As for now, I'm just setting up RBA and preparing a little bit for the things I want to do later on, part of which is getting hookshot as well. You can skip quite a few items if you want to, but it's usually faster to get them anyway, and they are important for some parts. Yeah, so when I recorded this, I had a slightly different route in mind than what I would consider ideal. And that's why some of this is slightly weird. Like, I'll explain to that when I'm executing it. But this is not the perfectly fastest method of doing this. Like, I explain it when I'm at the sections, but you can skip some of those parts later on. So yeah, I haven't equipped anything right now, and it's usually easier to equip, for example, the mirror shield if you're safe warping, but for some reason I missed that twice. I got kind of trolled by Dampy in this race, but most of that was my own fault because I... one part was I was rolling too fast, so I didn't get optimal rolls. And I messed up a little bit of the inputs there, so I wasn't really surprised when I got a horrible time at the end. Yeah, I just walked into that instead of avoiding it. It's usually not too big of a deal to get a 48 on the PAL version, but my movement was really sloppy and I got hit by two fires in this one. But yeah, the in-game timer is slowed down as well, that's why it's not bad at all to get the sub one for the hard piece. But yeah, you don't need any health upgrades, like there's not much fighting going on in this puzzle. So yeah, if you feel like getting hard pieces or a hard container somewhere, go for it, but it's usually not necessary. Okay, so what I'm doing now is I'm safe warping, and this part is kind of similar to no wrong warp because I need to RBA a bunch of things, but I'm getting the hookshot earlier because I have to do stuff before trading for Kojiro. And yeah, I'm not overriding the bombs right now, because there are basically a few different routes you can do with that, but the fastest one keeps bombs, which makes equips a little bit slower. But there's no problem if you're over-equipping bombs. You can either get Legit Bomb back, or you can trigger Adult Reset later on by defeating Ganondorf and fighting Ganon, and then warping out with a Warp Song and Ocarina items. That way you can become swordless and like trigger Adult Reset by becoming child and adult again. Okay, so now I made it nighttime, and this is to make the pocket egg hatch faster, and I'm not waiting in front of Kakariko. Also, that was a beautiful bonk. I love those parts where you can just bonk with the tip of your toe at a wall and you're getting the full recoil. Yeah, so I realized I didn't have a shield equipped at that time, and for quick draw you need a shield. If you were able to use explosives, you could do it without water, but I had a lot of restrictions, so you couldn't do it with juice, for example. And since you equipped a sword, you couldn't do a long range RBA, and you had to equip a sword, otherwise it wouldn't be able to escape the forest. And you couldn't beat Deku Tree either. Okay, so I messed up the setup a little bit because I did a backflip instead of a side hop there at the end. But I still got bottle on B now, and this is an important part of the run. First thing was I RBA'd the empty bottle with bugs, which granted me a third bottle, or a bottle in the third slot. It was my second bottle overall. And yeah, I need bugs in a lot of things. I wanted to forbid fish, because one thing is it changes the setups for Bottle and Bee, but that was not my intention. There's a different, or it's way easier to do Bottle Adventure with fish. And I wanted to avoid a few other things where fish are useful, so... Yeah, it had a few reasons for me to ban fish. Or you can technically buy a fish if you aren't, like, doing it, like, screwing up the other rules. But I'm not sure where you could buy a fish without manipulating a fairy in a really weird way. And yeah, if you just have it, it's not that... like, it doesn't save time. It's not that much of an advantage. I realized that I was really late on the cycle there. So I dropped the box here to RBA Pocket Egg. And what that does is it gives you the 20 capacity nut upgrade, which I had previously, so it didn't really matter. But it also gives me a 30 stick capacity upgrade. And I thought you would need it in that part, but you don't need to do that. Now that the egg is hatched, I can RBA Pocket Cuckoo for strength, and that's why I didn't wait for Kakariko, because I don't need to trade it right now. I need to do a few things with Black Gauntlets. And yeah, so I'm just equipping my things right there for the upcoming section, because I can't afford to trade the Cuckoo right now. I need to delete the Black Gauntlets later on in order to get the Golden Scale and obtain Ruto's Letter. If you already have Ruto's Letter, you can just keep the Gauntlets, and that changes your adult routing by quite a bit. Yeah, with the Black Gauntlets I can pick up Bomb Flowers, and I used that here to get Garn Tunic. It's possible to skip Garn Tunic, but it's slightly difficult for the section inside of Deathmon Crater where you obtain double magic. So you'd have to like probably catch a fairy, which wouldn't be a problem at all. But it's like the routing I did, it was faster to do like this, but you can skip Garn Tunic. But it, yeah, it grants an easy access to Deathmon Crater, so I thought it would be easy to do it like that. And if you grab the Bomb Flower early, you could just walk a little bit away of the Goron and you can hit him with the Bomb Flower. It is kind of tricky at first, but you can get it eventually. And yeah, since I don't have bombs right now, and I can't get a bottle on my bomb slot because it's forbidden in the restrictions, you have to blow up this part in Lost Woods to access it. So it is kind of strange what I'm doing there, but I'm not going down right now because I can access the bomb flowers over there a little bit quicker, and they have a really long timer. I got stuck at the fence there, kind of, and I already thought I messed up the movement there, but the explosion still triggered the other bomb flowers, fortunately. So yeah, it probably saved like half a second or something like that. But yeah, it's funny to test various things when you're playing this. I actually figured out a few setups for the PAL version. One of which was the setup for the high jump there. I've done glitchless runs on the NTC version before. So you side hop there, and then you ESS turn for one frame, crouch step, and then you ESS turn for another frame and crouch step. Then you ESS turn up, and then back walk just against until you're against the wall. I messed it up in this part, but I like aligned it manually, which is slightly slower. Or it's faster if you can execute it decently. But the setup is technically there to allow that part. If you're on NTSC, you're easier to... It's just easier to backflip neutral roll side hop twice and then you're at the correct position. Like, and the PAL setup is slightly slower, but it still works consistently. You just need to adjust your mid-air inputs if you get a weird angle before going for the jump. So yeah, unfortunately there aren't many cutscene skips. But I was trying to make up for execution, but somehow the upcoming section isn't too good execution-wise. Okay, so yeah, I still have Black Gauntlet, and the problem is I designed the route to require you to have a strength upgrade later on so you can do the Dongo's Cavern, but since you can just buy bombs in Ganon's Castle when you have a bomb bag, you don't really need that at all. The requirements for buying bombs aren't beating DC, but it's actually having the Goron Ruby. And you'll get that when you RBA for Song of Time to open the Door of Time. And that way you can trigger like things, but the problem is you usually aren't allowed to buy stuff unless you have a healing fairy nearby. So now I'm just doing Forest Temple to trigger the prelude cutscene so I can turn child again. But I can't open the Door of Time right now, so I need to do a little bit more of the trade sequence. But before I can continue the trade sequence, I need to do everything which requires strength, because I'll delete strength. And one part is basically... well, I'll explain that when the route is at that point. Well, that was a kind of sloppy bosky skip. This fight is pretty funny if you don't have a shield at all, but fortunately we can do ISG strats here. Well, yeah, so there's nothing special going on right now. It's just storing Massasaur Jump Slash for Power Crouch steps later on. I would really like to enjoy or to skip the next cutscene for beating Forest Temple, but I wasn't able to include that into the puzzle. And I got really trolled by the positioning of Phantom Ganon here. Like, he's usually not right above you. I messed up, like, every movement in this part. So I didn't get the 3 hits at the beginning. And then I messed up again. And then he trolled me again. So, yeah, I'm ashamed for showing a 3-cycle Phantom Ganon here, but that's how life goes. I should have practiced this fight before, but yeah. This is just demonstration mode. Perfect execution run. So, yeah, well, you can... Health management isn't a big deal, but if you want to, you can get the heart container here. It doesn't waste much time. There aren't too many safe warps, so you don't get any free refills, but you can usually farm health somewhere if you need to. But most of the time you don't even need to worry about your health anyway. But yes, so talking about the different routes, it's not required to have the stick capacity upgrade at all, because you don't need it to BA any of the higher values anymore. I knew that, like, to begin with, but I thought it would be cool to route it in. But it turned out to be a lot slower, and you needed to take 2 trips to Ganon's castle, which I was avoiding with this route. So yeah, it's slightly more boring, but you can skip the stick capacity upgrade there, so you don't need to RBA Pocket Egg. To explain a little bit about the background story of the puzzle, I was in the IRC channel and people were thinking about hosting a New Year's Eve puzzle, and it would be amazing if it had a puzzle theme, and New Year's, like, the celebration of the New Year is something that's very common in many parts of the world, and my association was, like, fireworks thing, but the question was, how would I realize that in a puzzle? And so I said, or at first I wanted to help Natalia Has Died to come up with a puzzle of his. But on my way doing that, I figured out something which would be a puzzle for itself. And then I was trying to elaborate on that a little bit, and Natalia Has Died helped me a lot, actually. But we didn't have that much time before it was actually New Year's Eve. And so I had to do a few things on my own, and the main problem I had was wording things properly without, or like, giving clear instructions on what to do in the first place. And I tried to do that after the puzzle or during the puzzle in the IRC chat, but it didn't work out too well, so I don't blame anyone for getting mad at me. I'm really sorry. Yeah, so I thought, it's not only the celebration which you can do with fireworks, but it's also like the beginning of a new year. The time-wise mechanic, and I thought I could include that as well. But I never posted like a fancy extra picture with the background story of everything. But yeah, it's it features a lot of adult child stuff, and that's not only because of Bottle Adventure, which you need to activate later in the run to obtain certain items. It's also the Spirit Temple, like in a casual playthrough. The Spirit Temple is the one where you need to be both adult and child to complete it. and I thought I would kind of use this idea but mix it up a little bit, because New Year's Day is also the crossroads of time in this way. So it's kind of funny that you finish the spirit temple, or you obtain the mirror shield as child, which you're supposed to get as adult. And what I'm doing right now is I'm preparing Link, or I'm preparing the spirit temple so I can complete the child segment as adult Link, which is kind of funny. You can do it as child Link as well, but you'd have to get ZL and then do the fancy trick across the spirit temple statue once more to get to the other side on the hand, and that's quite a pain, and so it's faster as adult anyway. And that's why I'm going back to spirit right now and open to push the first block. And yeah, you can do a little bit more of the temple, basically until you're in the main room. But it's faster to just push the block now and do the rest later on. But yeah, you don't need silver gauntlets in this run. Like, silver gauntlets is what you get if you beat the child segment with the key, with the Zelda's lullaby key in the main room. But yeah, you can skip that entirely by RBAing or by buying the bombs later on. I originally planned on making the second goal of the puzzle, which was blowing up the Gossip Stone. I want to do that as Child Link, but the problem is the way I intentionally routed it didn't skip the quiver, and you had to skip the quiver in order to be able to use bombs as Child Link. Or you could child PA bombs, but I didn't like the idea of doing that. So yeah, what I'm doing right now is I'm crossing Haunted Wasteland reverse, and I haven't really timed it if it's faster this way or just safe warp and go from the Temple of Time again. I had to check my angle there, so to make sure I'm not voiding out there, because it puts you all the way to the other side again. I think you can just backwalk across the sand pit if you're coming from this side, but I wanted to make sure I wasn't voiding out there, so I used the route or a way where you're walking like not into one of the seams there. And yeah, as Adult Link you can get caught by the guards right next to the gate. And yeah, and that way I didn't have to cross the Gerudo Valley Bridge right now. Okay, so I watched Sniping, who was the first to finish the puzzle, by the way. And Sniping did ledge clip inside, or to get into Gerudo Training Grounds early. But I haven't practiced that trick, so that's why I'm doing old school strats here. There's a way of clipping into Gerudo Training Grounds if you're having hover boots, but apparently that's not an option. So So yeah, what I'm doing right now is just setting up to get into Gerudo training grounds. Because we need ice arrows, fire arrows and light arrows. And I originally planned to obtain ice arrows as the first pair. Because that skips a huge part of like temple segments. You technically don't need to enter any dungeon at this point. Like after beating Forest, it's only Ganon's Tower which you need to enter. And this seam is really easy to seam walk, but for some reason I messed it up this time. I was like right at the end and I had a bad angle there. I have no clue why, I usually don't even align with the hookshot. People came up with that seam choke because it's so big. Yeah, so what you're doing here is you're using the anti-gravity glitch by sliding along the ceiling. And that way you can bypass a loading zone trigger and unload the like the gate blocking the entrance to the training ground. And I'm not really trying to complete Gerudo training grounds right now. I'm just trying to like make a path for later on, because I don't want to encounter any fights. I'll explain that in more detail in the second part of this puzzle. But yeah, I'm just collecting this key here. You can collect 6 keys and then get it legit. Like, you need a total of 7 keys, but there's one key hidden after the first small key room, or the first small key door to be precise. And you can't kill the Beemos as adult without bombs or juice. So the route through Gerudo Crane Grounds is slightly different. And yeah, I messed up the routing. I didn't have an optimized route through this room. You're supposed to go right first and then like do the middle section and then go up again on the left side. But it doesn't waste too much time. It was just sloppy execution. Because now I have to walk all the way up again. Alright, so technically you don't need to do this, but I did it for safety reasons. If you're getting legit 7 keys, you want to push this block, unless you're getting silver gauntlets later on. But to not get destroyed by the wolves later on, I made sure to kill them all, because they won't spawn again if you've killed them. But in order to do that, you need to kill every one of them, and there are 4 in total. So yeah, I wanted to safe warp there, but I wasn't sure if that actually triggered the permanent flag. So I waited for the chest to appear. And yeah, you can either like grab the key right there and push the block. Or you can do the trick I do later on. I've come up with a certain setup for it. It was a trick or a setup found by Exodus. To gain or to get ice arrows with only 2 small keys. But if you're going for the legit way, you have to make your way all the way around. You don't need iron boots, but you need arrows and something to shoot the arrows with. So now that I've pushed everything and did everything I needed strength for, I can delete my strength to obtain the golden scale. Again, this is only necessary if you don't get silver scale early. This is a setup I came up with, but I messed up the backflip, or the side roll after the backflip. there are multiple ways of getting bottle on B, but this one will be used a few times within the run. I'm sorry for everyone who hasn't done like a lot of quick draw bottle on B practice before. I think this was kind of painful for you then. Okay, so maybe I can talk a little bit about RBA and BA in this part. It was an essential part of the puzzle, and it's difficult to figure out what you want to do when. Because again, if you mess up like your pocket cuckoo RBA, you won't be able to get that later on. Of course, you can always get the silver scale as Schalt later on by the rock RNG part. But it's way easier to do it like this. Okay, so what I did now was I woke up Talon in order to create the pocket cuckoo. But I haven't RBA'd the pocket cuckoo yet, and that's something you shouldn't do on other versions. Like, I equip pocket cuckoo on C right now, and this is a really, really short time saver, and you shouldn't go for that. I just did it because I was unhappy with that part, and I thought if I had to re-record this segment, it wouldn't be bad at all. But I didn't want to spend a lot of time recording this. Unfortunately, it took me quite long to get this to record the post commentary. Like, I did it in one sitting, but I couldn't record some stuff because of problems with my microphone. So what I did there was I mashed B during the collection delay. That way I can empty my pocket, the bottle, while having pocket cuckoo on C right. That way I deleted the black gauntlets and I got golden scale. And then I could RBA bucks with Kojiro on Z-Ride right after that to get Quiver 20 and Bombback 40. And this is a really important part. Like, I'm just continuing the trade quest right now, which had really sloppy movement, by the way. So yeah, I explained the importance of the golden scale for me to dive to Ruto's letter, which you'll see later on. But I haven't explained a little bit about Bombback and Quiver problematic in this puzzle. If you obtain Kojiro and you RBA it with anything, you'll always get either Quiver Bombback 30 or Bombback 40, which means if you open the Bombback chest in Dodongo's Cavern, you won't get the bomb icon there, and you won't get 20 Bombback in your inventory. Or in the inventory slot, but you'll get a Bombback 20 on the choose slot, which can be equipped. But you can't use bombs using that Bombback, though. That's why this is kind of weird, but it gives you one bomb. And that one bomb was usually planned to blow up the Gossip Stone. Like, you only had one shot at it, basically. But I wasn't strict at the part where you need to blow up the stretched Gossip Stone. Like, if people stretched it and then blew it up somehow right next to each other, that was fine with me. I'm showing the intended part at the end of the run, and basically everyone did it like that or very similar to that, so I didn't even need to be picky. That was really fine in general. Yeah, so if you go for a Bombback, you need to have the Bombback item. Oh, sorry. You need to have bombs on your C buttons so you can use them. And that's really important. And you can either trigger Adult Reset, or you can BA bombs. But it's crucial that you can use bombs in some way. And this is probably the fastest, or the faster method. The other thing is, you can also skip RBAing Kojiro, and then you can get Ruto's letter and manipulate your arrow count with that. But it's not that... it's not fast at all. I can explain that later on, but basically if you don't have a quiver, whenever you shoot an arrow, the game realizes, hey, you can't carry any arrows, and sets your arrow amount to zero. Which means every time you want to shoot an arrow, your arrow count will be set to zero, and that is really, really bad if you want to shoot 50 arrows at the end. So the fastest method would be buy bombs, get arrows and RBA arrows at the end. So yeah, the crate quest is like similar to any of the RBA categories, but you don't have bombs available right now and you can't use chews. Chew hesses would be pretty sick. But yeah, I didn't want to change the rules that you can use chews to hesses adult. Like, I didn't want to make it inconsequent, kind of. So yeah, you can either skip getting quiver to get Legend Bomb back, or you can skip a Legend Bomb back and get a quiver by RBAing it with bugs, which only gives you a 20 quiver, by the way. I kind of messed up my routing on this segment. I forgot that it was night and that you couldn't hookshot the ladder here. So yeah, that was like probably the worst time loss in this section. Yeah, that was really sloppy. That was basically the other important thing I wanted to do, like, by restricting the fish. You couldn't RBA Kojiro with a fish, and what a fish does is it gives you a legit quiver 30, and it gives you a 40 bomb back. So by doing that, you can basically... you mustn't have anything in the bow slot either, so you can't trigger normal arrow drops, for example, and you can't, for example, spawn the lady at the horseback archery minigame in Gerudo training, in Gerudo Fortress it is. But some people really thought if I had trolled them there, like it was basically some kind of troll thing. You have to shoot 50 arrows, but you can't get 50 arrows. But that was basically to hint people at there that there were other ways of having arrows. So yeah, this is one important part. You want to have odd potion, and by RBAing odd potion with bugs, you get quite a few things, and you delete a few things. For example, you delete the Gerudo membership card. So if you want to get it for some odd reason, just get it after RBAing Odd Mushroom, Odd Potion, sorry. The main reason I RBA'd it is to get Song of Time, to open the Door of Time. So yeah, we are approaching the end of the trade sequence for now. I mustn't RBA the Broken Goron Sword right now because it would trigger Light Arrow cutscene. And you talk to Zelda at the end of Light Arrow cutscene. And the rules say you need to have all three magic arrows and not just Light Arrows. That was another way to prevent weird BA things, and you couldn't get light you couldn't get ice arrows by having light arrows equipped and shooting them. So yeah, that was a little bit of other things to figure out, I guess. Like in which order to do what. So what I'm doing now is... I was playing Requiem to warp to this part. And if you RBA Poacher Saw, which I obtained back there, you will get a few warp songs, but you'll also delete warp songs on the other way, on the other hand. So yeah, it's kind of tricky, to be honest. But if you just use the song you need, and you don't need to return to this place later on, it's really easy, and you can just delete the warp song. That's what I'm doing right now by RBAing Poacher's Saw. Requiem has a value of 2, and blocks basically have 1 in every bit except 2, 64, 32, and 128. Now I can equip the sword again. You can also get by hitting the boulder on a certain part, but it's a little bit more convenient to do it with the sword jump slash. But yeah, as I mentioned before, you only do this to get silver gauntlets, and you'll see me not use silver gauntlets in the rest of this part. I just showed it, basically, if anyone would get confused with... Like, you RBA strength, then you delete strength, and then you need to do another visit later on with Celus Little Boy. I was kind of hoping to get more people into puzzles by doing this puzzle, but it turned out to be a really weird puzzle to figure out. And so I don't think it was very beginner friendly. But it wasn't really hard to execute besides that one jump in Spirit Temple, or the two jump slashes, basically. This was like the only that has never happened to me before part. I got trolled and I bonked right into the handle of that statue, and then, yeah, the wall master really wrecked me there. So yeah, that was another huge time loss, basically. At least I got a damage boost. Okay, so now I'm at the adult side. And I can collect a small key, which requires me to place it out. And yeah, if you had to play or had to use Ocarina items every time I played the Ocarina, you would have lost quite a bunch of time. So yeah, maybe it's more convenient to do Aqua Escape. But it's technically faster to do Wes Escape here. And I got a really bad backflip angle, so I wanted to adjust my position. But I got so far off. That way I couldn't hookshot the chest. Should have just climbed the trail side. I've done that a few times in my Norwegian warp runs, but I really choked in this part. If you pick or try to push the statue while turning your camera, you will pull it once, so that happened to me there as well. Unfortunately, I have to cross this room, the upcoming room of the child segment. And pulling the sun isn't a permanent flag. I think it stays if you die, but whenever you leave the temple, it gets reset. But yeah, for anyone interested, I was playing on the 1.1 version of PAL, which was like released after the 1.2 version of NTSC, and it's basically the same version Virtual Console has on the PAL version. I was kind of surprised that I got both of these jumps, like the side hops when you pull this up. But yeah, the symbols are still the same as on the console on N64, but VC has different textures there. Yeah, so this fight was kind of easy because you could go berserk on him and just use power crouch steps like all of the speedrunners do. But I think the child fight proved to be tough for a few people. So yeah, I just got the silver gauntlets, and although the owl isn't there as Adult Link, you still trigger the small cutscene, which we'll play in a second. And then Noboru is getting caught. This cutscene even plays after defeating Noboru Knuckle, which is kind of funny, but yeah. The game never intended you to get silver gauntlets as Adult. Alright, so I've already beaten the Forest Temple, and I collected, or I didn't collect them, but I RV8 the Spiritual Stones, and I got Song of Time. So I can turn Child again, but the question is, why do you need to turn Child again? Because there's nothing really you can do. That's partly true. One major thing I have to get still is Ruto's letter, and that's the only way of getting arrows before accessing Ganon's tower. And I also need to set up BA. It's kind of funny because you can basically BA Megaton Hammer, or you can get Bolero, get the boss key with the small key from the Runya's room. Then you can BA Megaton Hammer. And yeah, you need to BA the Megaton Hammer to hit the switch, but fighting the Flare Dancer is way better with Hookshot and Master Sword. I'm catching a fairy now because I use that to BA later on. I'll explain that when we finish the Child 2 segment. I really messed up playing the prelude there. Playing the Ocarina on the PAL version is kind of difficult because it's eating so many of your inputs. If you want to go fast, like, you have to let go of the previous button and then hit the next one in order to have the game register it. And if you go really fast, it won't work at all. If you're warping into the Temple of Time, you have to enter it through the normal exit again. Otherwise, you won't open the Door of Time if you play Song of Time here. Like this, I pressed the C button for down, but it didn't notice it. I was actually considering getting Sun Song in this part. Like, I have Nocturne right now. I could warp to the graveyard, get Sun Song instead, and skip the prelude cutscene. And Sun Song would help me later on in the run, so it might be pretty close overall. I can't tell for sure because I haven't timed it. But getting Sun Song might turn out faster. But it's something which isn't necessary, so I didn't really want to include it in this intended solution. But yeah, Sun Song would be amazing to skip this cutscene. I don't know a setup with the Door of Time opened, to be honest. But there will be one eventually. Thank you. Yeah, so you can't enter any of the trial dungeons, or you couldn't. You could enter Deku Tree, but it wouldn't really help you. There's one thing which was kind of funny. Mido is still there if you turn child now. But you don't need to do Mido Skip to enter Deku Tree, because you already got Kokiri Emerald from RBA. You can just talk to him and he'll talk to you about how you're to blame for the death of the Deku Tree. And yeah, Sniping actually did Mido Skip with the old school Macaron setup. And yeah, shoutouts to him at this point, he was pretty awesome in this race. And I tested that part as well, like, I did Mido Skip as well, I realized that way too late. So if you're inside the Deku Tree, there's nothing really you can do without Kokiri's shield. You can get map and compass, but you can't do 2-3-1 skip with a mega flip because you don't have a shield. There might be other ways of doing 2-3-1 skip without ISG and hovering and stuff like that. But the 2-3-1 scrubs have to be hit by their projectiles, and there's no way of reflecting them. Well, you can child BA Megaton Hammer, but that's, yeah, far from being fast. So yeah. And the other thing is, a slingshot would have been beneficial in Spirit Temple, for example. But the problem is, to get the slingshot, you have to return the projectile of the other scrub as well. And the other scrub can't get killed by Chooze or any other item. I've tested that before in like the puzzle routing. So yeah, that was pretty fancy. I wanted to include a little bit more child stuff for just for the sake of the puzzle, basically. But it didn't turn out to be very suitable without like changing so many other things, and there were already way too many restrictions. And yeah, so Natalia has died, was trying to help me there a little bit and make it more interesting. And we were talking about a lot of things actually to improve this route. Or not to improve the route, but to improve the puzzle itself. And I'm really thankful for all the input I got there. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to convert that into a puzzle, so I basically came up with two different puzzles. But I couldn't finish the other one, or the way I finished it was, there was a lot more action going on than in this puzzle, but it wouldn't be so much to figure out. So yeah, it's, I just went for another Scarecrow song. You need Scarecrow song in this route because you're getting fire arrows without beating Water Temple. And there are quite a few ways of doing this actually, but this was just the fastest and most convenient one for me. And I'm not going into Sora's domain to empty Ruto's bottle. That would be really bad. Like, you can't beat this puzzle without Ruto's letter. But I'm going here because it's the fastest way of getting Deku Sticks. And as you've already noticed, I still have the first bottle on Sea Ride. And I made sure to catch a fairy in the first bottle. And yeah, now I've farmed two Deku Sticks. You can do that in Bottom of the Well and just not kill the Iron Knuckle at the end of Spirit with a Deku Stick. But yeah, with four Deku Sticks in your inventory amount, you can have fairy equipped to your C right button as Child Link. It's important to have that as Child. And then the game Well, I'll explain BA in a second. Just something to notice, Child Link has Garn Bracelet right now, although I never obtained Garn Bracelet. But that happens because the game puts it, or like shows it, and Child Link acts like he had one. If you get any of the higher upgrades for your strength, like Silver Gauntlets, Golden Gauntlets, or any of the RB8 colored gauntlets. So the way how BA works is, I'm not going to explain this too much into detail, but BA is like RBA but in reverse, Kefa. So yeah, when you have a bottle with something in your... it doesn't need to be a certain bottle, like it doesn't need to be empty bottle or box or anything. It can be like... It could even be something like green potion or something like that. It just needs to be a bottle with certain item or nothing at all in it. And you need that on your B button. And when you go child and adult again, the game wants to update what is in your bottle. Like if you caught something as Child Link, it had to update that into your adult screen. And it checks what the value is you have on that particular slot. And if you have a fairy on C right, that is the address for your Deku stick count. So it checks my Deku stick count, what the content of my bottle on the B button is. And the game never, the game designers never thought you'd be able to have a bottle on your B button. So that's why they didn't check it. One thing to note here is, I emptied the box while having Ruto's letter on C-Right, which granted me arrows to shoot later on, because I still have the Quenty Twiver from Kojiro RBA. And I don't need to keep box if I want to BA. So yeah, I have a bottle on my B button, I have 4 Deku sticks in my inventory right now, and I have the fairy in bottle 1 on my C right button as Child Link. And what that does is it puts the value 4 into my B button, onto my B button. And the value 4 isn't even a bottle, but that doesn't matter in this case. I was just trying to figure out my equips for after that part, but it doesn't really matter, you can do that later on as well. And the value 4 on the B button is fire arrows, but it's not like the fire arrows you would equip if you had them legit. Like, I just need to grab the Master Sword right now. It's basically the magic arrow icon which appears on the screen or when you obtain them. Like when you pick them up. But they behave pretty much the same like if I had equipped them. Like the icon there is pretty weird. That's not something that's on your C buttons. But you can BA that, and it's way easier to achieve than, like, let's say value 40 something, or I don't know the value for fire arrows plus bow. But yeah, so now I have fire arrows, but you might wonder, why do I get fire arrows? I don't even have magic. I don't need magic in order to do this. But it's more convenient to get magic arrows, because I can't get a bow on my B button right now. A bow is a magic, or it's a minigame item, and it's not that easy to BA minigame items in this game. You have to be in a very specific condition, kind of, to have them stay on your B button and to be able to use them. So what I did there was I just got another item which happens to be the fire arrows, because they're the one with the lowest value. Like, I didn't want to collect 20 sticks or something like that. That would have been hilarious. And yeah, I need to make my way to Gerudo Training Grounds now to obtain Legend Ice Arrows. And I need to shoot a statue there. And I'll explain about GTG in a second. But first I need to cross Gerudo Bridge, which would be something awful, kind of. because you shouldn't be able to wake up Talon in the first place, because it usually correlates with you having something in your child item crate slot. But if you had managed to get that, you would have broken the puzzle pretty big time. You could get milk, RBA your bomb count that way, which means you wouldn't have to buy anything or something. You could get Epona's song. You couldn't get Epona Legit though, because you'd have to pay rupees and there's no way of manipulating that many fairies. Or at least none that I know of. That was the problem in... what you saw me doing there was a hookshot across the Gerudo Bridge. You do that by inching to a very specific spot. I know that most people on the NTC version still know the old school setup. I think it was by Akrite. But it was really weird with all the C-up strats and everything, and I didn't really like it. And it wasn't even I wasn't even able to do that on the PAL version because of different roles. So I came up with a faster and, in my opinion, easier setup, where you need to do shield scoots. And then you need to do a hookshot turnaround trick where you face the opposite direction you actually want to go. And you pull out the hookshot, hold down on your control stick, press A to cancel the hookshot, and press hookshot right again. One frame after that. I used to do it unbuffered. Some people like to buffer it, but it's not too difficult. If you only miss the input by one frame, you don't even fall off. Like, it's not difficult at all to do. I'll probably record another tutorial of that trick. I somehow skipped the text boxes of all those carpenters in the first time I got through, but I triggered both of them the second time. The ledge clip would save a lot of time here to enter Gerudo Training Grounds. But yeah, it was kind of convenient that I could create the saw right there, because I already RB8'd the saw. And I need Broken Goron Sword to get the Spirit and Shadow Medallion to trigger Light Arrow cutscene later on. And yeah, there we go. Second scene walk. I'd usually say it's easy every time, but I really choked at that point. I don't even know how I could choke so hard, but that's something that's usually not big of a deal. And you can use Navi, or if you have a sword you can get ISG in seam walk, but my problem wasn't that I was falling off the seam. My problem was that I didn't get onto the seam properly. And this is usually very easy to seam walk. But yeah, without a sword or Megaton Hammer, you can't ISG. Can't get ISG. But yeah, it's not big of a deal anyway. So this is where fun starts in Gerudo Training Grounds. I've already completed the first section, so I don't need to worry about anything there. Gerudo Training Grounds is a little bit longer if you don't know how to do that skip that I'll do in a second. But yeah, as I mentioned before, you can just push that block and then collect a few keys. That was weird, like I have no clue what happened there. You need to activate that switch first to open the door. There's some weird behavior with items on your B button, whenever you pull out like the arrow, it resets your direction or the angle, the vertical angle you're facing, basically. That's why it looks kind of weird. But yeah, you get another key here. I'm not sure if it's faster to get this one or maybe skip this one and get another one. But you basically need two small keys. By voiding out, I spawned back at the entrance up there and the bars disappeared. I didn't activate Scarecrow Song, so I couldn't hookshot off. But this is where the fun starts. I know this is a very long setup and it's PAL only. You can't just copy the inputs and do it on NTC, you'll end up at a different spot. But I might eventually just figure out a setup to do it on NTSC. If you watch Exodus, he did it with a little bit of alignment. But it's not too difficult to get ice arrows with two keys here. The setup is still faster than being slow with the alignment, so I basically prefer this one on the PAL version. And it's very easy to do, it's just a bunch of side hop scrolls and things like that. I'm equipping the sword right now because I'd get a stick on B button if I quit. Or if I save warped, basically. And I didn't want to crash the game. But yeah, you have basically three keys up to that point. Then you can do the roll invincibility chest in the next room. Then you can play Song of Time to get the key in the other part. No wait, you have... I forgot to count the one key you get from the strength upgrade. So yeah, that would be six keys if you get the one next to the Song of Time block in the lava room as well, with the roll invincibility one. We're actually already 2 hours into the run. And yeah, that's where a decent runner on NTSC could have finished. But yeah, there's still quite a few things I want to talk about, so I'm kind of glad that it's not over yet. Sorry for bugging you with constantly talking. Yeah, so there's still quite a few things I want to get, and my main goal is still to collect the three magic arrows. And I could beat Water Temple by RBAing ice arrows and just get, let's say, yeah, you can, if you RBA ice arrows with bugs, you'll get the boss key in Water Temple, but you'd still need to, like, do a weird thing to get to the boss room. And to avoid that, you can either BA Longshot, or you can get Longshot Latchet, which takes quite a long time. So if you BA Longshot, you might as well get Scarecrow Song and get Fire Arrows. So what I did there was I RBA'd Ruto's Letter again. That refills my arrow amount. Like, I shot only 4 arrows, but it's, I need a certain amount of arrows later on, and you'll see that when I get there. Okay, so yeah, this is basically a lot of setup what I'm doing right there. I need a bottle on my B button to be able to access Bottle Adventure again. You notice that I have 20 sticks right now. By RBAing by RBAing the Pocket Egg, I got a 30 capacity upgrade. And sticks are most convenient to manipulate for me. So, yeah, if I only had the 10 capacity upgrade, which is the default one, when you obtain sticks for the first time, you can't do what I'm doing there. So you'd have to manipulate it in another way. But yeah, RBAing Pocket Egg isn't bad at all, so yeah, just for this little trick, it's kind of decent. So I still have the fairy on my C-right button, and now I have 11 Deku sticks. And this puts the value 11 on my B button, because I had a bottle on my B button when I turned child. And I'll keep the fairy on my C-right button. By the way, I got 20 Deku sticks by getting empty bottle on B while having fairy on C-right, because empty bottle corresponds to value 20, for those of you who didn't know. I know that every one of the race people knew that, but there are still a few other ones who try to get into puzzles and are watching this, so I hope you can learn something from this as well. Okay, so the value 11 corresponds to Longshot on your B button. And that's pretty fancy, because I don't need to do any of like the dungeon stuff to get fire arrows. I really liked the section that Sniping did. He had a few cool tricks and he got Longshot Legit. It was actually intended to get fire arrows before or light arrows at some point, but I thought it would be cooler to have the Guru Training Ground section. Unfortunately, some people figured out to break that part anyway. So just something to say at the beginning, I messed up my day-night cycle management, or I didn't really mess it up, but when I was Child Link, it was already day, and I couldn't make it to this part before dawn. So yeah, the problem was I couldn't make it here and get lighter fire arrows immediately. So I kind of tried to waste my time there. But I tried to collect a few rupees on the way, so this is basically just the boring part. But yeah, if you get fire arrows, you can RBA fire arrows to get the boss key and map in Fire Temple. And if you BA Megaton Hammer and have the boss key already, you can just enter the boss room and then kill Volvagia. Like, that's probably the fastest method of doing this. And you only need to kill Volvagia and beat the Fire Temple if you want to enter the Dongo's Cavern as Child. But yeah, being able to open the Bomb Bag chest is really cool. There's a little bit of glitchless stuff going on in DC. I would have liked to show it in this run, but it would have taken another like 10 minutes to finish those parts, and I didn't want to make it any longer as it already was. But yeah, beating fire and DC, or you didn't even beat DC, but you just did like the glitchless jumps and fought the Zelfos with Deku Sticks and Kokiri Sword without a shield, which is pretty fun. If you get Legit Bombs, you can like go crazy all over the place, but you still don't have Hover Boots, so it's mainly just doing Super Slides, Hesses, Mega Flips. But it's really awesome if you get Bombs Legit, you can Weird Shot to Ice Arrows and skip that part. I was just trying to farm a few rupees, by the way, here. I had to wait until day, and I don't know any lag reduction strats for Lake Hylia, so I was just like trying to do something useful, but I couldn't think of anything. What you will notice here is I have 193 rupees, and I mentioned before that I need 200. So I was trying to farm a few more, but I forgot to farm the ones next to the scarecrows, and I didn't want to be late for the morning. So I thought I would just get them later in the run. I didn't really have a rupee route as adult, I was just trying to pick up a few on my way everywhere. But I could have got like a red rupee chest somewhere, or maybe in Dampy's grave, for example. Oh wait, I didn't have the upgrade there. So yeah, although the text or inscription in that part says you need to shoot the sun when the water rises, you can trigger the light arrow spawn, the fire arrow spawn, sorry, even if the water level is still low. It's just usually not possible to collect them. But yeah, that with Longshot on my B button I can do that. You noticed that I had 29 arrows before, that's because bugs have value 29, and when I shoot them, the game lowers the count, and then realizes, hey, you can't carry more than 20 arrows, so it sets my value to 20. That's to prevent like collecting more arrows than you can carry. And the 20 quiver is a glitched one, which I got from RBA. And I shot a few arrows away intentionally. And I had 17 arrows remaining, which is really important for that part. Because it sets up something I'll do after fire arrows. So now I have ice arrows and I have fire arrows, which means I'm allowed to get light arrows right now, but I don't even have the medallions to trigger light arrow cutscene, and it's not intended to beat Shadow and Spirit Temple, because that would be a real pain. So yeah, what you end up doing is you RBA Broken Goron Sword. This will give you fire, water, shadow and spirit medallion. It will also delete Minuet and Bolero. So you want to finish everything you need to do there. Otherwise you'd have to travel the whole part again by foot. Okay, so what I did previously was always set up my Deku Stick count for BA. What I'm doing right now is I'm setting up portal on B into RBA stuff. And I'm not going to RBA Broken Goron Sword just now. By the way, you can quick draw with Longshot on B. I forgot that, and maybe the timing felt awkward, I don't know. But it's usually easier for me with a sword on B. And I usually have my bugs on my right button when I do a bottle on B, because I'll catch bugs on my B button bottle and have an empty bottle on C right, and this will ride the bugs on my bottle 3 slot, and this is important so I can keep bugs in my inventory even though I empty them all of the time. Okay, so yeah, as mentioned before, the adult equips don't matter for bottle adventure, but the child equips do. And this part is kind of crucial because it matters later on in the run again. I'm child now, and I don't want to have long shot again, and I don't want to manipulate my stick count. So since I already have 17 arrows in my arrow count, I can equip Ruto's ladder on C right, and this will give me the Megaton Hammer on my B button, which is pretty awesome, and I need that later on in the run. So yeah, although I pulled out the Master Sword of the pedestal of Time, I have Megaton Hammer on my B button. I never got Bolero of Fire because it was out of the way. And since I only need to visit that part once in the route I'm doing, I decided to walk there from the Minyard Warp, which is kind of slow, but I couldn't figure out a faster way of doing that. Another beautiful bonk. Yeah, my equips are really sloppy at some point. I don't have Seria's song at the moment, so I can't bypass Mido the legit way. But it's kind of convenient to just walk out and walk back in, because the warp is kind of far away and it doesn't lose that much time. So yeah, this is like the reverse Mido skip. You might wonder why I'm getting Megaton Hammer on B, although I didn't say I wasn't going to beat Fire Temple. The restrictions still say I mustn't use Choose as Adult Link, and there are quite a few things I have to obtain to finish this puzzle. Or it's not that much, but... that's what I'm going to do right now. I can't shoot magic arrows unless I have magic. So yeah, I'm just preparing a little bit of stuff there. That was a really bad angle for this trick. Yeah, so blowing up the Goron early on in the run made me access this part without weird clips, and I don't even have hover boots. And that was the most convenient way for me of getting double magic, which you need in order to shoot all of those arrows. It's a little bit tricky, like, the arrow amounts I posted weren't quite random. I thought about, like, I had something in mind to make this a little bit more tricky, to be honest. But I couldn't, like, do any other thing which wouldn't have sound completely stupid, so I stick to having 10 fire arrows, 10 ice arrows, and 30 light arrows. And it wouldn't require what I had in mind there. So yeah, since this isn't the Japanese version, there's quick text coming up. And that's maybe the only positive thing. I'm not sure how much the Japanese version would save in this route. I think it would be roughly 10 minutes. Because you're watching a lot of cutscenes. Now, it might not be 10 minutes, maybe like 7 or 8. So yeah, this wall can be blown up by explosives, but also using the Megaton Hammer. If you get a Legit Bomb back, you can just blow up the wall. And you can either Mega Flip or Super Slide past the rocks there, depending on whether you're doing it as adult or child, or what your preferences are for that trick. But being Megaton Hammer is really fast, so it skips a huge segment. And that way I can just get both magic upgrades. And then I can RBA Broken Goron Sword without having to worry about losing either Minuet of Forest or Bolero of Fire. But yeah, if you want to beat Fire Temple, it's really easy to RBA Fire Arrows before BAing Megaton Hammer and then just destroy Volvagia. And that's where getting Goron Tunic really saves a lot of time. You can probably do it with 2 fairies and 3 hearts, or getting the heart container from Forest Temple. But yeah, it would still require you to get like 2 fairies or something. Maybe you can land a few snipes in midair using arrows and power crouch stabbing before Volvagia hits the hole again. But that would be really weird. And I still can't play the ocarina. Yeah, so this part is like where many of the different routes came back together again. Like, you can basically choose which magic arrow you go first. You can choose if you want to get bombs, legit, or have a quiver instead. But they basically all come together when you obtain light arrows. That's basically a little bit how the puzzle was designed to be. But I couldn't. I wish I would have like allowed more variety to the gold solutions. I was really trying to figure that out, but it was really difficult. So yeah, I wish it would have been a little bit more open in the routing part. But it was my first puzzle, and I didn't really have time for the fine adjustments. I've had quite a few people giving positive feedback. And yeah, thanks for everyone who gave me nice critique. But I was also happy to to hear the opinions of the people who told me what I was basically afraid of. Like, I basically knew that the wording was horrible. So yeah, what I'm doing right now is I already triggered the medallions by RBAing Broken Goron Sword, but I also RB8 bugs in my Ruto bottle. Emptying the fairy was just preparation for later on, so I have an empty bottle, but it was actually slower to do it on that section. I should have done that later on. Now I'm triggering Light Arrow cutscene. And Light Arrow cutscene is usually just, yeah, watching cutscenes for a long time, but it also features a very interesting mechanic. I don't know at which part, but you're going into child and adult for... Yeah, you don't even notice it, but the game puts you into child mode and then back into adult mode. And if you're... This can trigger adult reset, but it can also trigger bottle adventure. And if I was to enter this part with a bottle on my B button, it would have put Megaton Hammer back on my B button, and that would be counterproductive because I was trying to design the puzzle at first, so you would have to BA either green potion or blue potion, and that wouldn't be too big of a deal. Like, you could RBA a fairy on your B button with a fairy on your C right button. This would give you 24 sticks. Then you'd either have to break one or two sticks to get blue potion or green potion. But then you'd have to carry bucks in one of your free bottles. And in order to BA again, I would have to equip fairy on my C right button as child before, and that would waste time, and that's why I didn't go for it. But yeah, since I didn't allow any of the other inventory slots to be turned into a bottle, so you can't carry bugs with you without occupying an extra space. So I thought I might as well carry bugs in my B bottle to RBA more arrows later on, and that way I could just buy another potion, which means I'd have to spend more rupees. And this is like where the route got a little bit weird, I have to admit that. But if you mess it up the first time, you can just farm a few rupees and then just go back again and do it all over again. It doesn't waste that much time if you know what you're doing. But I had to think for a few moments there as well before I did that. It was kind of late when I recorded this, and there was HDDQ running in the back. Yeah, my concentration wasn't top-notch. But yeah, it would be possible, or it's not that slow to BA green potion or blue potion. But you'd have to get a fourth bottle anyway, because one bottle needs to be Ruto's letter, one bottle needs to be bugs, and then you need four magic bars. You enter usually with the full double magic bar, and then you need three refills. And you can either have three in your bottles, in your inventory bottles, and bugs in your B button, or you have bugs in one of your inventory bottles and you need green potion or blue potion on your B bottle. So that ends up like putting you into a weird spot where you have to decide on what you want to do. I thought it would be pretty cool to end it like that, but I didn't want to make the video any longer. I kind of went over my estimate. I thought I could finish in like 2.5 hours on the PAL version, but I messed up a lot of movement and equips, and sometimes even execution part. But yeah, I can use this cutscene to like finish up a lot of the commentary which I left open before. You need a fourth bottle in your inventory anyway. So one way of doing that would have been obtaining Nyru's love, if you're getting bombs. That wastes a lot of time, and you have to do that before you obtain Ruto's letter, kind of. And I didn't even know, or I haven't tested if that was possible. I didn't think it would be possible at the time I published the puzzle, but it might be possible, and there's even a way of getting past the wall in Nyru's love, or in the fairy fountain there, but I think it involves explosives as well. So the easy way of doing this is buying a red potion in Ganon's castle and RBAing the red potion for the fourth bottle. But that puts an extra 40 rupees to your counter, and yeah, it adds up a lot actually. So that's why I had 200 rupees as my planned count. Unfortunately, I forgot to collect some extra rupees in Goron City when I passed that part. But I thought there would be another convenient way of obtaining them. But you'll see what I do as a backup strat after this cutscene. There are other methods of getting a fourth bottle. Sniping did, like, the very pro way of doing this. There was another puzzle, like, I think it's more than a year ago already, where you had to be a big pose and show them to the guard in the guardhouse. Or it's not a guard, it's like the collector of spirits, kind of. And then you can get all of the... If you do that 10 times, you can actually get the bottle there from him. But yeah, the most common version was just to RBA Red Potion, which is linked to your fourth bottle slot. Yeah, but shoutouts to all of the people who participated in the race. I was mainly talking about sniping. He had a few cool routing attempts, he got ledged bombs, and he did like the puzzle in a really pro way. He had very creative versions of doing this, and he also finished first. He didn't cut the sub 6, but he was still pretty awesome. He was closely followed by Mr. Bubbles, who also did a very amazing performance. He had a few problems in the spirit segment, but that was due to bad visual cues, and it's kind of annoying if you are trying the same setup over and over again and you're already kind of tired. But huge thanks to him at this point for sticking around for so long and never giving up. He also did very few cool things, like he BA'd the pocket cuckoo again. No, he BA'd pocket cuckoo. And that way was able to... Yeah, he basically did a lot of fancy stuff. He BA'd with the pole and 44 shoes, so he had to get Ganon shoes and the shoes in Spirit Temple, and then manipulate his shoe count in Spirit Temple. that was pretty fancy as well. Like, so many people had cool attempts of doing this. Psymarth finally figured out to do this as well. Like, his time wasn't too bad. He finished a little bit over 8 hours, actually. But yeah, a lot of this puzzle was to figure out how to do the child segment. The adult section was just a little bit of figuring out minor stuff. I wanted to do like a little bit more puzzly thing where it wasn't that clear what you had to do. But yeah, it turns out to be really annoying if people don't understand what you're saying. And of course people doubt like the quality of the puzzle if your wording on some other things is bad as well, so I totally understand people there acting a little bit like weird at some points. But yeah, I tested this puzzle before, and I hope this video shows that I'm able to pull off every glitch which I required you to complete in this puzzle. So yeah, what I'm doing here is I'm buying my stuff, and I have 2 empty bottles right now. So yeah, the top the business scrub completely on the right sells red potions for 40 rupees, and I was trying to pick up the rupees there as well, because they drop 3 rupees if you have full health and 3 hearts if you don't. So what I did there was I empty bottle RBH red potion, which gives me a fourth bottle, but I don't want bugs in there because I'll keep bugs on my B button bottle. I only RBA'd that to be able to catch bugs without obtaining anything weird. It's not because I needed the arrows to go. I forgot to equip the hookshot there. So yeah, I have 116 rupees right now. And I was trying to grab a fairy right there. Unfortunately, I missed it. So, this is the first green potion which I bought. And I need two more, so there's basically one more rupee which I need to obtain. So I thought, yeah, okay, no problem. I can just get one now. And for some reason I thought the fairy just healed me there. It didn't go, so I couldn't get the rupee spawn from him. And I need 40 rupees to get the last green potion. And so I wasn't able to do that, and farming rupees there is really slow. Which means I didn't even know if there's a faster way of doing this, but the spirit trial was the only close part which came to my mind. So if I had one more rupee at any point after the first 5 minutes of the adult section, I would have probably made that. Yeah, so this is my third green potion. This is all I need. And I already bought the bombs, which you can see that my bomb count has risen to 5. Unfortunately, you can't warp out here, so you have to walk all the way back, because if you save warp, your bottle will be gone again. But yeah, this is basically as much of preparation as is necessary to complete this goal. I have Ruto's letter, I have bugs, I have 3 green potions, I have bombs, and I have all 3 magic arrows. And I'll start with the part in London Ranch. The time of day is kind of decent for that right now, because it just turned night. I should have used the bombs actually earlier, or, well, I was just trying to show that you don't need any explosives there, but technically I would have used the super slide to London Ranch. This puzzle was designed to avoid any explosives. I had bomb restrictions, like the day before I posted the puzzle, but I cut them out to not destroy any fun people could possibly have. Psymarth, who finished third, did the way I planned it before by opening the bomb bag chest in the Dongos Cavern while having RB8 bomb bag 40 before. So it places a bomb bag 20 on your 2 slot, and it puts one, your bomb count is increased by 1. So he has 1 bomb, and that means he couldn't like do weird and fancy passes, weird shots, super slides, whatever. So now I'm equipping that part. I wasn't like planning on any intentional order you'd have to shoot the arrows in. But I started with fire arrows, and then I'm switching to ice arrows because it fits nicely to my magic bar. You notice my arrow count is still at 11, but that's because I started with 29 arrows. And yeah, I'm just distributing them somewhat evenly across the sky. Now there's not really anything of optimization going on there. So now I'm finished with 2 other arrows, and I need to RBA my arrow count. And although my magic count isn't completely at the bottom, I still refreshed it. It's usually recommended to take your time here to not mess up anything stupid. Because if you like RBA an empty bottle and it puts bugs on your green potion slot, you're you basically messed up. And this is like what happened again. I RB8, so I had 29 arrows. And by shooting one arrow, I ended up with 20 arrows remaining, so I basically had 21 arrows to shoot. So those have been 12 light arrows so far, and that's exact capacity of your double magic. It's 24 of either fire or ice arrows, or 12 light arrows, or 4 Nairu's love, or whatever. You can figure out yourself. So yeah, it was designed to make you use more than 3 of double magic bars. But it wasn't tight, like you could waste some magic on the way. If you skip a quiver, you have every time you shoot an arrow, your arrow amount will be set to 1. And this is taking an eternity if you're doing that. Like, I can shoot arrows after arrow, but if you get a legit bomb back and decide to skip the quiver, you're going to have a bad time. Okay, so I'm done with 30 arrows right now, 30 light arrows. But I decided to brighten the day of Melon at this point. So, yeah, Happy New Year to you as well. Don't forget to have some magic going into Sora's domain. That's where the mentioned Gossip Stone is located. Most people didn't have any problems figuring that out. But yeah, the description wasn't very precise or informative, so I think it might have been confusing, but I hope no one felt bothered by that. It wasn't like a very fun part of the run, it was just like an intentional add-on, basically. And it fits to the last part of the descriptions quite nicely, and it made the obtaining bomb thing a little bit more funny in my opinion. I don't think this was a very great puzzle, but it was the first one I did and I was kind of short on time, and unfortunately Natalia has died and couldn't help me as much as he wanted to. So yeah, it would have been a little bit better if I had more time to work on. This will probably not be the last puzzle I come up with. But I promise that the next one will be more elaborate on the restriction combinations and not as confusing, and people shouldn't come to a point where they think, wow, I can't do anything right now. And yeah, the nighttime wasn't part of the restrictions for blowing up the Gossip Stone. So it doesn't matter if it turns day right now. I had horrible equips there. I didn't know why I equipped Hookshot in Lolan Ranch. So about the Gossip Stone thing, it gets stretched in a way that it's getting bigger than before under one circumstance. You need to hit it with something magic, and that can be either Dean's Fire or one of the 3 magic arrows. You can shoot it with anything you want, but Dean's Fire is... You need to get legit bombs in order to obtain Dean's Fire, unless I'm missing like a weird Ferrous Windrome Warp or something like that. So what I'm doing right now is I'm just shooting an ice arrow and then I'm timing a bomb pullout so it gets blown up. Thanks everyone for watching this, watching the race and participating in the race. It was kind of fun for me to do that, and I hope you enjoyed it as well. I wish you all a happy new year, have fun, and I'll see you guys around.